So good afternoon, and it's good to see familiar faces. So today I'm going to talk about a little more specialized subject called trauma, healing, understanding and healing trauma. And of course it's not going to get completed today itself, so we'll go slowly. Some of it you have already heard from me in under different topics, but I will still go a little more deeper. Okay, I'll speak louder. So the mic is not working. Okay. So so this is the intent with which I have planned today's talk, which will be approximately 30 to 40 minutes. Is let us understand what does trauma mean. So I had this surprise. I was talking to somebody and that person says, okay, but what does trauma mean? And I thought trauma is something which is very commonplace and everybody understands, but that was not true. We'll explore some types of trauma, and I will only talk very briefly on how do we deal with trauma. And all, so the basis of my talk is of course something called as somatic experiencing, which I'm undergoing training, but I'm not, this talk is not about somatic experiencing. So the base is that, of course, my understanding, my learning is from there. But the talk is broadly about what is trauma. So we become traumatized when our ability to respond to perceived threat becomes overwhelmed. So anything that for a few minutes or for a few seconds makes you feel that the situation is not under your control, there is really nothing that you can do about it, trauma happens. So when we meet with an accident, we fall seriously ill, we have very high fever, we have a fight with somebody who is very important to us, or we feel hurt. Even if for a few moments, if your body experiences that this is too much for me to handle, then trauma happens. That's the basic definition of trauma. But nobody has really been able to exactly define trauma. So in fact, Peter Levin says that after 30 years of doing work in this field, I cannot actually specify what trauma means. And then he goes on to put this as a definition. So trauma is just one second, I'll just take you through that. So trauma is fear. Trauma happens after fear. Trauma happens after pain. So for example, say I was in an accident and I fell down, and so I had pain, I had fear, but the moments when I fell, there is nothing I can do about this. I cannot get up, I cannot move, I may die, something else may happen. When all that was going on, I was in an immobile state. So it's like the body actually plays dead for a few moments. Your nervous system actually plays dead. That is when trauma occurs. So fear, pain, yes. But different people will go through something differently. So somebody might be in a very big earthquake but may walk away less traumatized, and somebody may be in a small cycle accident and may feel more traumatized. And there is a variety of reasons why such a thing happens. Yeah. So we say that trauma is a loss of connection, where for a few minutes, for a few seconds, and maybe for a lifetime, you never really feel connected to yourself. People who go through horrendous wars, rapes, murders, I mean, seeing their near dear ones being murdered, who go through, and I'll talk about the types of trauma, sometimes lose the connection with themselves also. In fact, it is said that when you go through a trauma, a small part of your soul actually leaves your body. Is lost. The small part of a soul is lost. because that connection with the body is lost for that small part, and it shows up as different kind of symptoms. You lose connection with yourself, you lose connection with people near and dear ones, with your own body and the world around, right? So for example, there is this very telling story of a US veteran. He was in the army, and for about 4 years, this guy, on every 5th of July in the morning, he would get in to a shop, put his hand in the pocket as if it's a gun, and will show the gun to people and will take away maybe $5, $10, not really a huge amount of money, and he would walk, and then he would wait for the police to arrive and arrest him. He was repeating this every year because 5th of July something used to happen to him, because he was in a war setting, he experienced something. So during those moments of activation, his connection to the rest of the world was completely lost. He did not know what he was doing. See, the danger could have been some security personnel could have shot him, thinking that he really has a gun. That's the danger. Yeah. Trauma can occur in a normal day-to-day event. So you will just slip and fall, and it can be traumatized. You can be traumatized. It can be simple cuts, electric shocks, somebody suddenly coming in front of you, depending upon what your triggers are and how much activated you become. So just for a moment, what does activation really mean? Is you start feeling these sensations. I don't know if have you ever experienced a lot of fear rising for no reason, and your whole body seems to be, something is happening, something is moving. What is really happening is your nervous system is feeling that there is a problem. You can't cope with it, but it's still getting ready to cope. The first thing that any nervous system does is it first tries to fight. First, any danger comes, your first reaction is to fight. The second reaction is to run away. And if both does not work, then the third reaction is to submit. You fall down, you play dead, you become, you freeze, you actually freeze. You submit or you freeze. So it can happen with normal day-to-day events. Trauma is in the body and it is not in the event. That is the reason why it lives on. Because if it was in the event, then once the event is over, your trauma should be over. But your body remembers. And that is the reason why sometimes it reminds you years later. So something that you have experienced maybe as a child or maybe as a young adult, and then you start experiencing the effects of it in late 40s or early 50s. That is because as your life is moving on and as your other pressures from your intelligent mind are moving on, this is getting a chance to show up. So it will show up. It could be a state of depression, it could be a state of anxiety, it could be excessive anger, it could be excessive fear in certain situations. So maybe, you may fear going on an escalator, but you may not fear actually climbing stairs or going by a lift. But that escalator may scare you. Or you may fear speed. Maybe you may fear speed on a scooter, but you may not fear speed in a car. So you may fear different things. So it is always in the body and not in the event. And that is the reason why when we work with the body, that is when you can remove trauma. When you work with the mind, it is not so easy to remove trauma. Trauma is about the nervous system, which we have talked about earlier also, but I'll just briefly say that any input that comes to the nervous system through all your five senses, through your memory or through your intuition or whatever way, any input that comes to a nervous system, if it generates negative or rather uncomfortable sensation in your body, your body gets ready, your nervous system gets ready to react. So if you're coming very close to a very hot object, your nervous system is ready. If you come very close, if it's a little further away and you don't think that it can come close, nothing happens, your nervous system doesn't react. So what is the sensations and the feeling that gets generated in the body as a result of that? The nervous system gets ready. So trauma is always about nervous system. So when nervous system decides that I can do nothing, it plays dead and you get traumatized. And so symptoms, as I mentioned before, symptoms can occur years later.
But sometimes incidentally comes in the mind.
Yeah. Yes, you are very right. Because when I remember something, or if not just remember, if I'm say I start telling you something, you know, it happened 15 years ago, this happened, I was going here, and I start describing, my body starts remembering the same sensations and feelings that were there 15 years back. So when the same thing happens, then it relives that experience, and the nervous system again gets ready to do the same thing, because last time it couldn't complete. So it is again ready. So if that time I couldn't, for example, say I was locked in a room and I couldn't escape, and now again I'm telling you the memory, again my nervous system is getting ready to escape. If it gets to escape, the memory's hold on me will go away. Now if I'm able to escape and get my body to feel that escape, the memory's hold will go away. Memory will not go away, but the memory's hold will go away. And once that happens, then I'm not traumatized anymore. But if that doesn't happen, so every time I tell you, say I'm filled with the same fear or same anger, and then I still don't complete it, then it stays. Next time it will come again. And sometimes it will come back as body symptoms. It will come back in form of heart diseases, in form of cancer, in form of, I don't know, in what are the various ways in which it will keep coming. So there are basically three types of trauma. They call it as big T trauma, are usually natural disasters, war zones. If you are in an event which is very big, and where you are a very small entity. So in a natural calamity, everybody around you is in the same state as you are. There's really nobody who is feeling safe. So in that case, those will be the big T traumas, the traumas that have a bigger impact. Then there are C traumas, which is actually the multiple deployments, oppression, racism, poverty, years of abuse. All that are the mid-level kind of a trauma, but they also traumatize. And then there are little T traumas like dog bites, dental procedures, small anesthesias, small operations. So there are these small T traumas. So I guess that understanding of what trauma is simply the place where your body has felt helpless. That is what is trauma. So even when the body experiences a heart attack, the body in itself feels helpless, and that also traumatizes. Anesthesia traumatizes for these reasons. Yeah. Now what happens, because you have been through certain kind of trauma, different kinds of symptoms may come in. For example, in hypervigilance, you are always, yes, you are always looking out for this, because, so at the base of trauma is what? Base of trauma is that your body does not feel safe. So anything, anytime your body does not feel safe because of the sensations that it is feeling, whether externally there is any event or not, you may be sitting alone in a room, nobody is bothering you, nobody is saying anything to you, but your body can suddenly start, those sensations can start, and you do not feel safe anymore. So when you don't feel safe, that is where the trauma has got activated. And that is why one of the key questions we ask people who are traumatized, so we talk about the event, we don't go deep into the event because, as you rightly said, it will re-traumatize. So we talk about the event in brief. Say a person is coming and saying, you know, I had an accident. So okay, the first question we ask is, okay, so when was the first time you felt safe? So once that container is created, then the person won't get more activated. Otherwise, managing that person's activation will become difficult. So when the person remembers that, yes, there was a time when I finally felt safe, the body feels good, and the body feels safe. So yeah, intrusive imagery or flashbacks will start coming. You're sitting, you see something which is, so when you were in a, when somebody was in a bad accident or a bad situation, there were certain things that were around, right? So there were colors around, there were other people, there were some, maybe some words were being spoken, something was happening. Those flashbacks will start coming. Sometimes extreme irritation with light and sound, little bit loudness, somebody speaking a little loudly, somebody's talking somewhere else, and the reactions are happening. Lot of mood swings, you know, your morning, half an hour before you were all jumping and happy and all that, and half an hour later you are like very sad, very deeply sad, and that's why, as you rightly said, depression. So you know, you're completely, you're up, you're down, you're up, you're down. Now there has to be a distinction between the depression that trauma causes, which is happening mainly due to body sensations and this, and the depression that happens because of chemical imbalances in the brain. Chemical imbalances can be caused by trauma, but then there is an additional step that has got involved in specifically in depression. But if there is no additional step, then it's only happening because of trauma. I'm sorry, but then there is this sense of, so traumatized people usually feel a lot of shame. It's like when you meet with an accident, especially if you are a little more adult, or even for a child, there is this sense of shame that I couldn't take care of myself. And it actually comes more from your higher brain. When an animal loses a limb or something, the animal shakes off that trauma. There is no self or worthlessness feeling in an animal for this. You know, it's human beings, because we have a higher brain, so somehow we think that we can control life. So every time the life is, so any victim, anybody who has met with an accident, who has been seriously ill, who has been raped, abused, beaten up, whatever, also carries a sense of, why did it happen to me? Something must be wrong with me. So a lot of shame and lack of self-worth is also caused by that. Difficulty sleeping and depression. So addiction is also these days being looked at as a result of trauma. Addictive behaviors, some addiction to certain things are also being seen, because there is a lot of material in our unconscious which goes into, and I'll touch upon that a little bit, that when trauma happens, some memory actually gets into your unconscious. There is a memory that, yes, it is escape route, but escape of what? Sometimes imagined, and sometimes an escape from the sensations that you can make no sense of. So see, say I am right now standing here, and you know, I'm in a talk, I have chosen to come here, people are here and all that. And I may suddenly start feeling something, say, in my heart which I can make no sense of. So when people at some point start getting those sensations on a regular basis, depression that happens, anxiety that happens. You're sitting in your house doing, it's a house where you've been always. It's not that first day you are in that house. And people who suffer from anxiety and or depression would start suddenly getting these sensations with where they don't know what to do about it. So how do you do it? You distract. How do you distract? So sometimes you distract with chocolates, which the world does not see something as something bad. But you may distract yourself with their alcohol or with drugs, which the world starts looking at it as bad. But ultimately, addiction to chocolates is also addiction. So anything that is obsessive, which you can't let go of, is addiction. So addictive behavior. So how much of it is really imagined, I don't know, but is very closely related to what you want to escape from. What is it that you want to get away from? What is the pain that you want to get away from? Inability to bond. Not being able, because as I said before, trauma removes you or disconnects you from other people. So you don't know how to build relations or how to bond, because when those sensations happens, you can make no sense of it. You can see the desperation in other people's faces. So then you don't want to be there. You don't feel safe. In a group situation, you don't want to be there. So they have an inability to bond as a result. If you have been faced. Reduced ability to plan, you know, decision making. I've seen people that till the last minute they are in that whether I should do this, I should do that. You keep two dishes in front of them, they will keep wondering which one they want to eat. You keep two clothes in front of them, they will keep wondering which one to pick up. So that is because they have lost that grip on it's okay, whatever happens, I will eventually take care of it. So even if I pick up one dish and I don't like it, I can always throw it, I can pick up the next one. That's all right. Digestive problems, psychosomatic illnesses, which I said that sometimes then your trauma symptoms can start showing up in form of psychotic. So whole lot of cancers are related to psychosomatic. Heart diseases, diabetes are related to psychosomatic reasons. Autoimmune diseases are all psychosomatic. So our ability to understand that if I'm having some sensation which I can make no sense of, but it is still natural because it is happening in my body, and can I stay with it, can I be with it, will depend on whether you are able to deal with trauma or you are not able to deal with trauma. Yeah. Yes. Trauma therapy. Yes. So that's a not just psychologist. So if we go through all the trauma literature, if you read about what different people on trauma have written, even in psychologists there are two kinds of therapists. There are talk therapists. So they talk to you about your problems and they try to give you ways in which you can do that. What has started happening with the trauma moment was it was becoming people were realizing that unless you involve the body, because trauma lives in the body and not in the event, if you don't involve the body or if you do not work with the body, then your trauma healing cannot happen. So unfortunately specialization does that. When you become very specialized, your understanding of other areas becomes very difficult. Yes. And that that is the reason why so much awareness is required. And frankly, I wouldn't really blame. I mean, 4 years before before I was introduced to the trauma healing methodology and started training, I also would have probably gone to a doctor when I started experiencing. And that is the reason why then addiction happens. People search for alternatives in places which can be dangerous and so on. So trauma, understanding that trauma and really having that awareness that what is happening to me, is it really physical, is it psychosomatic, is it psychological, it takes time. And that is the reason why our connection to the body is extremely important for us to be able to heal trauma. Yeah. So some of these symptoms a doctor can actually help. A medical doctor, I mean an allopath or a can actually help some of these. Some sleep disorders can be dealt by with him. Some of the other psychosomatic illnesses, once the illnesses occur, you can always go to a doctor. But working with the body is of extreme importance. So we talked about fight, flight, freeze and submission. So how body plays a role? So because nervous system is in the body, we are talking about the body, and we are saying that our tissues and our body cells have the capability of storing the memory of the event, any event. I mean, our body has the memory, and it has, that is the reason why we are shaped by our experiences, literally shaped by our experiences. There are people you will find who are, I mean, if you look at their body language, it's not really straight, and it's not the, for example, even my shoulders are not absolutely straight. So they droop, okay, or they droop, or one shoulder may be a little more stiff and ahead, and another shoulder may go back, or something can be happening in your sides or backbone. So your shape, your legs, all bones can also, I mean, your shape of the body, sometimes it's muscular, can also, the muscles also can shift shape because of the memory. If that has happened because of trauma, as you start healing trauma, your body posture will also change. That's the proof of it. So body plays dead when you go through trauma. So if there are different ways in which we can awaken the body in those spaces, and body does not understand the language that I am right now speaking. So I can give a whole lecture, but the body doesn't understand. Body needs to understand through sensations and feelings. It needs to start feeling sensations. It needs to start feeling safe. The more safe your body feels in every situation, the less traumatized it would be. So I was talking about memory, and there are two types of memory that all of us have. This is something which is with all of us, which is declarative and non-declarative. The declarative memory is the memory that if you remember, is what we can speak about, what I can describe. This happened and that happened, factual memory is my declarative memory, and it starts at the age of 3. But the non-declarative memory, so there are different versions to this, but the non-declarative memory, they say, starts from the second trimester in your mother's womb. That is the 3-month-old fetus onwards, the implicit memory has begun. So your body understands sensations and feelings much earlier than it understands language. Before you understand language, your body already understands what's happening in the environment and what's safe and what's not safe. So, but what happens during trauma is the same declarative memory actually gets suppressed, and that is also another problem with talk therapy, because they are going to talk to you and you are going to respond based on what memory is available to you, whereas that memory is actually suppressed. That's why in people who face major natural calamities, big major accidents, will never be able to give you a single coherent story of what happened. Sometimes they will say something, sometimes they will say something, sometimes they will mix it up. Bigger events, you will not get a coherent story because your declarative memory was suppressed. It was not picking up information. Because obviously, you're going through trauma, you're trying to either fight or you're trying to run or you're trying to protect yourself. You're going to pay attention to only those things which are important for survival. Nothing else. So that is why it is suppressed and it is speechless. So if you really want to understand what your body is saying, you have to sit down and listen to what are the sensations that are happening. What are you feeling? Are these sensations making you comfortable? Are they making you uncomfortable? What is it that your hands are and legs are trying to do? Do they want to move? Do they, you know, what wants to happen? If you pay attention to that, then your implicit memory can come out over a period of time. So when we do this kind of therapies, we really can't promise that in the very first session some major change can happen because we don't know how your body is going to respond. So I have had one case where in the very first session something happened, quite dramatic happened. So we were talking about a totally different event. That person had come to me because he was going through something and wanted to, you know, was feeling a lot of pressure and this, and we were talking about what is the pressure doing to you, what is happening to you. And suddenly the person's body moved in a particular way, I mean just like, you know, it shifted, and I said, what's happening there? And then she said that she saw an image of some event happening, and we worked with that image. It had nothing to do with pressure, it had nothing to do with what she was going through currently and all that, and we talked about that. And what we realized is that she was having a lot of problems with her legs. She had not come to me with those problems. She had come to me for something totally different. We worked with her problem with the legs, and her problem got resolved. And that was in one single session. But that's, what do you say, luck? That's absolute luck. I cannot promise that next time somebody comes, I can do that in one session. But otherwise it takes time, because it takes the person. One, we are not very used to working with our bodies. Most of us are really not trained to do that. And two, once we start working, then slowly the body systems start opening up and showing up. So, very briefly, because I'll go into depth in the next session, but the process, so these are some basic premises. You can be fully in charge of your life if you fully acknowledge the reality of your body. What is happening to you right now? If you fully acknowledge it, then your healing can start. What we normally do, if small headache, just a small headache, it's just a small muscle pull, it's just a small accident, we quickly start moving. I think I've shared this before also, that somebody had once told me that when you fall down, what is it that you should do so that you don't get traumatized? So normally our tendency is, if I fall down, I will immediately try to get up. If I can't get up, there will be people around me immediately who will try to pick me up and say that, you know, get up. But a good thing to do is, once you fall down, just keep sitting there for a second. Look at the ceiling, look at if the ceiling is in the right direction, it should be above. The walls are in the right direction. I am fine, and then I get up. Which means my body has got time to realize that all is well. So once we start paying attention to what is happening to our body, that is the time when healing really happens. And most of our suffering is because of the lies we tell ourselves. We don't want to go somewhere, but we go there. We don't want to do something, but we do. I'm not saying let's all become rebels and not do a thing we don't feel like doing. But we need to have an awareness that when we push our bodies to do things, we are putting a pressure on our bodies, and we just need to become more conscious about that pressure. Huh. Huh. Huh.
As you told, for some time, right? And when the other vehicles, it was a road, vehicles were moving. So other road, other vehicles, sound he heard. After some time, going to suddenly go running towards the bush or something, to protect him.
Yeah. So animals are like, so. They orient them, it's called orientation. They orient themselves to the space.
Normal human, if we look, something happens, we immediately try and that.
Rush.
Yes. We are not preparing.
Yes. That is what, sir. That's why, even that is the reason why doctors say that when we tell you the bed rest, when we tell you bed rest is bed rest. It is not watching, looking at WhatsApp either. But we don't realize the impact that it has on us. And so if you realize the impact it has on you and then you choose to do it, that's fine. But a lot of us do it habitually, impulsively. Yeah, I have even observed that I had come back from this Vipassana, if you have heard of it, the 10-day meditation retreat. And I came and after some time I switched on the TV and it was like, it was so jarring for a few minutes that I switched it off. Because the body was so used to being in a particular way that it couldn't take the sound that fast. Then slowly I heard other sound, then slowly and steadily, then I went and watched whatever I wanted to watch. So understanding what you're feeling, fully exploring it, and then going ahead and doing things, it helps you heal trauma. So essentially when I say that we want to heal trauma, there is one concept of boundaries. So what is essentially trauma? We all have boundaries. Our skin is our first boundary. The skin on our body is our first boundary. That is why operations can be traumatizing, because it actually is cutting your skin, so it's getting into your boundary. We also have space around us. You know, we are not comfortable all the time. Aura is okay. That is the space you have. But all the time you can't be sitting, touching the another person. No matter however close. All the time you can't do that. Then there is a psychological space where you want to do something and somebody is intruding. You want to say something and somebody is interrupting, or you want to do something and somebody is telling you what to do and what not to do. All this can create trauma. And the best way to heal is start looking at what are these boundaries. Where are your boundaries? Yeah, it's not something that I can quickly do in 2 minutes, but just let me give you an example. That say when you're ill, okay, there is a part of you which wants people to come and meet you. You want to be, you know, like I used to have a favorite tagline which used to say, "Bimar banne ka fayda kya agar koi dekhne wala bhi nahi hota," you know, so what's the point of falling ill? But when you're ill, your body needs a little bit of spacing. And in that need for having people around or people coming to check, many times we don't realize that body needs a continuous space of rest to heal. And we allow people to come in. What we are actually doing is you are allowing people to intrude into your boundary and you are delaying your healing. That is the same thing with trauma. If you are feeling scared, however irrational it may be, you know there is nothing wrong, you are scared for no reason, even then, it is very important that you keep your boundaries and say, okay, for the time being, I am feeling scared. Let me come out of it. I don't want to be helped here. That is extremely important. Secondly is the body language, which is the sensations and feelings, which I think I have elaborated quite a lot in my very first body talk session. Where how do you look at your sensations? The stories that body tell, so your body is actually, so those images which I was talking about, this lady saw that image of or childhood, or you may remember some smell, or you may remember some or any of the five sensations, that story. So there is a story around it, and if you are able to go deep down and remove the story with your hands, actually doing movements with your hands, you are telling the body that I have removed, or I have fought back, or I have run away from something that was disturbing. Actually, physical movements can help. And of course, as I said, traumatic memory. So not worrying about whether this is true or not, whether it really happened or not, whether that's not important. Your body is remembering it. Don't go into whether it is true or not, because anyway we said we will not re-traumatize, right, by going into details. Go into the two-liners, work with it, get it out of the way so that your body doesn't feel it anymore. Okay. So these are some five aspects of how do you heal trauma, and I will, in the coming sessions, I will take each one and go deep dive into it. Yeah. So any questions you have, Varsh? Okay, so thank you very much.